Approach flight 1388 with ditching for Fenix. Ditching. Request Fenix for ditching.
After line 288, please request vectoring to the sea area, please. We will be ditching. Aircraft completely unstable.
On October 2, 2018, an Embraer 190-100LR aircraft, operated by Air Astana, landed at the military airbase of Alverca de Ribatejo, Portugal, to perform a scheduled heavy maintenance work package. The heavy maintenance work, scheduled in accordance with the aircraft maintenance program, consisted of a basic inspection, named by the Part 145 as C2 check. C2 check is a kind of reoccurring check that the aircraft has to go through at a certain number of cycles or hours. Then, on October 9th, the maintenance crew started working according to the bulletins, which changed the type of routing of the ailerons' control cables, with the replacement of pulleys in respective structural supports by a non-contact support, aiming to reduce the control cable friction on that area. As you can see here, some of the items should be removed which are related to the ailerons. According to the service bulletin, the mechanics in OGMA should replace the installed stainless steel control cables with carbon steel cables. This is one of the main points in the story. Remember this. After finishing the work related to the ailerons, a group of mechanics began testing the system for the correct operation of all the parts that were replaced. But a surprise awaited them here. After aircraft power-up, a message appeared in the engine indication and crew alerting system, which is called ICOS, that the aircraft cannot be dispatched for flight due to problems related with the flight control system. Flight control no dispatch. This work took 5 days until October 31st. During this time, several tests were performed on the aircraft, including engines run-up and the aircraft final inspection, which included the flight control tests. However, the maintenance personnel did not identify the inversion of the aileron control cables during this late operational check, even though the maintenance instructions required them to confirm the correct surface deflections with control wheel inputs. After a period of troubleshooting, which ran until November 11th, the aircraft was prepared and positioned for the operator's delivery crew that was waiting for the maintenance work completion and documentation delivery. The crew arrived at the site to receive the plane and carry out the return flight to the airline's base. During operational checks and acceptance by the crew at 11:25, a problem was detected related to the ventilation in one avionics compartment and one hydraulic system was found low, which led the crew to not accept the aircraft, requesting maintenance intervention. Once the problems were solved, a new flight preparation cycle was initiated by the crew, following the operator procedures. The flight was expected to go from Portugal to Minsk in Belarus, initially for a refueling stop, and then proceed towards Almaty in Kazakhstan. The aircraft performed the taxi to runway 04 threshold, which after traffic coordination between Alverca and Lisbon ATC services, the crew initiated the takeoff at 13:30, without reporting any additional anomaly. Before we continue, it's important to understand how an airplane moves along its roll axis. There are two main systems that control this. The first one is the ailerons, which are flaps located at the outermost part of the wing. They move up on the side that is going down and down on the other side, causing the airplane to roll. The second system is the flight spoilers. When you command the airplane to tilt one wing down, these spoilers come up on that wing. They reduce lift on that wing, hence making the airplane roll. These two systems work together to achieve the same goal, with one being more effective at lower speeds and the other at higher speeds. For this flight, the crew was scheduled as follows. The captain on this flight, 40 years old, and had 6,009 hours of total time. First officer, who was 32 years old, and had 2,692 hours of total time. There was another third pilot in the cockpit, who was younger than everyone else and had a little more experience than the second pilot. He was 26 years old and had 3,514 hours. In the cabin as passengers followed three operator technicians, the director of technical asset management, a maintenance technician who followed the C-check, and a material supply technician. As we said before, in the cockpit who's seated on jump seat, third pilot going to become really important. Keep in mind, too. In accordance with the available meteorological information for Alverca Military Air Base, the local atmospheric conditions were characterized by low ceilings, reported a first layer at 500 feet and a second at 1,500 feet, with a horizontal visibility of about 2,000 meters with rain. The wind reported by Alverca Control Tower was 050 degree with 7 knots. In shortly, this type of weather was not the best for receiving and testing an aircraft that came out after extensive repairs. But the deadlines were tight for everyone, even the crew. Just after taking off on runway, 04 occurred at 1331. The captain tried for the first time, without success, to activate the autopilot. At 1332, still in contact with Alverca Tower and on initial climb heading, the crew declared emergency while trying to diagnose the cause of the aircraft's abnormal roll attitudes, receiving only autopilot system fault information, without any other associated messages. As per aircraft flight data, at 1333, the crew first activated the flight control system direct mode. The direct mode, which means you will fly on aircraft with cables, not with electronic signals. You can only imagine what is happening in the cockpit at this moment, since the ICOS screen does not show the real air what is happening at this moment. Currently only shows the standard following notification. The first is a warning that you are flying too low. The second one is that you are flying at dangerous angles, and pilots can't see what was going on with the controls. This can be heard from the voices that were in contact with the tower at that moment.
Flying 1388, we have flight control problem. Aircraft lost flight control capability for climbing 10,000 feet by finish 1010, present heading.
1388, Roger, climb to 10,000 feet, QNH 1010.
As they're now trying to control the aircraft and they're calling to air traffic control with the Mayday call, the aircraft goes from plus 20,000 feet per minute to minus 16,000 feet per minute with G loads of plus 4.5 Gs to minus half a G. These are immense forces that are being put on the airframe, and the aircraft is turning over completely inverted. As you can see on final investigation report, shows us real-time the pilot flying monitor information. In contact with Lisbon Approach Air Traffic Control, and given the imminent aircraft loss of control, the crew requested several times headings to the sea, with the purpose of ditching to minimize aircraft damage and to protect people on ground in the event of an uncontrolled aircraft crash landing on land. But every time when the crew requested a heading to the sea, the aircraft immediately began to fly in the other direction. Now imagine a situation where you seem to be in control of the plane, but the plane doesn't recognize it. Do you remember that at the beginning of our conversation, we mentioned that there was a third pilot in the cockpit? Well, throughout these extreme maneuvers, he keeps giving advice, technical advice, and shows really good technical knowledge of the aircraft to the captain. And he also works as a relay between the cockpit and the passengers sitting in the back. So to try to figure out why the aircraft is doing this. During the struggle to control the aircraft, the crew noticed this fact. If you keep the flaps in position 1, which is between 7 and 15 degrees, then in this case it is possible to maintain the flight altitude, but not the roll. After such tests, it was decided by the crew to leave the flaps in this position. As you noticed at the beginning of this flight, the weather at the departure airport was very bad for such flights. After the crew found a solution to how to maintain the flight altitude, they began to think not about ditching on the water, against how to keep themselves in the plane safe and sound. The departure airport was in the north of the country. That day in the southern part of the country was sunny and calm. The crew now has to direct the plane to this part of the country in order to successfully land the plane. 1 hour 15 minutes after takeoff, The crew relaxes a little with the fact that they are finally able to control the plane. But the obstacle for the crew was not over yet. When they figured this out, they were also intercepted by two F-16 fighters from the Portuguese Air Force, and that came with some additional problems for the crew. The problem, though, is that as these two F-16s are approaching the aircraft, they forget to turn off their TCAS, which means that the crew is now sitting there with full-on TCAS warnings as well. So you can hear on the air traffic control recording how they're telling them to please turn off the TCAS.
Okay, could you please give us a space because we have TCAS moving
That is safety off now. Can you just start descending on the current heading?
At 14:45, the crew flew south for an expected difficult landing with limited aircraft control. At the beginning, the air traffic controller suggested an airport for landing in the southern part of Faro Airport. Since the crew had control limitations and lack of time to fly to Faro Airport, the F-16 pilots were suggested landing at Beja Airport, and they decide that they're going to try to fly a visual approach into runway 19 right, which is the main runway in Beja. The captain now starts aiming towards the runway. You can see from the flight records how they're never really stabilized. They're constantly moving left to right on the center line. And as they get closer, it becomes really apparent that he is not going to be able to stabilize the approach. So he's now going to have to go around with his flight control condition. Because of the physical exhaustion and unwell condition of the first officer, the captain decided to switch the co-pilot's position, where the jump seat co-pilot assumed the first officer position, helping the captain just after the go-around. So he now jumps in, and they go in for a second visual approach. The same thing happens. They destabilize at the late part of the approach, and they have to go around for a second time. On the third approach, the crew is still not able to get the aircraft in on the center line for runway 19 right. But this time, when the aircraft starts to drift towards the left, the captain just realizes that they have runway 19 left there, which is slightly narrower. But he thinks that he will be able to get the aircraft down on that runway, so he points at it. And at time 15:27, almost 2 hours after their initial takeoff, the aircraft lands safely on runway 19 left in Beja. As soon as the aircraft comes to a complete stop, the fault message, flight control no dispatch, comes up on their ICAS display. During the evidence gathering on the following days, evident damage was found in the fuselage skin panels, showing waviness in some areas. Tire number 4 was damaged when it hit a runway edge lamp during landing rollout. All wing fixed leading edges were found wrinkled. The damaged geometry was found sharper on forward and aft regions, and smoother on inboard and outboard regions, indicating that the damage was caused by wing bending around the wing core direction. There's only one injury. One of the passengers sprained his ankle slightly, and all of them are feeling queasy and completely exhausted of the experience. But apart from that, they're all fine. Why did the accident happen? Well, the team investigating the air crash found that the airplane was badly damaged. They looked into how the plane was maintained and found big problems with how the Portuguese maintenance team worked. They didn't report problems well, and the work wasn't done properly. Also, the manuals needed fixing to show how to connect cables correctly. Air Astana needed a program for pilots after big maintenance, and they needed rules about flying in bad weather. The pilots were also partly to blame because they didn't check the plane's controls properly before takeoff. If they had, they could have stopped the accident. But after takeoff, they did a great job working together and communicating well.